Well, it really is an honor to be back here and to be acquainted with Dr. Willerson and talking with Dr. Steinbeck and Dr. Navarijo and meeting with Dr. Coulter. I see Dr. Delgado. So lots of familiar faces, and had the pleasure of meeting with Dr. Lushanowski and Dr. Angelini this morning. And so I spent many days in clinic over in their office. So this is a special place. And at the time I was here, 2001 to 2010, absolutely spectacular. And hopefully you value the opportunity that you have here, because the medical center cannot be rivaled anywhere else in the world. And to have thought leaders like Dr. Willerson is an absolutely amazing opportunity. So it's really an honor to be here. And I wouldn't be where I am today without the foundations that were developed in this very hospital. So thank you once again. And it's a pleasure to talk to you. I want to speak a little bit about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy today. Some of this will be relatively basic, so I apologize for those of you that maybe it seems a little easy, but at the end, I think you'll see some things that are very novel that will really be transformative, I think, in the way that we manage hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in a non-invasive way, which is obviously very exciting. These are my disclosures, and I do a fair amount of consulting and research efforts. So I wanted to show this slide just so everyone remembers, the big statue outside in the hall. So this was when I was a young attending. I actually looked, happy, and I was walking around and doing good things. So you obviously recognize the gentleman in the other white coat, and the two people there are my father-in-law, who's a native Texan, and his wife, who's a native Texan. So one day I was at work and they were in town. They came up to see the place, and my father-in-law said, all my life I've heard about Dr. Cooley. Do you think that I could meet him? And I said, I have no idea. We can ask. So we walked up to his office, and he was there eating his bowl of soup, as he usually did. And I said, sir, I know this is a completely unusual request, but would you mind if we took a picture? And he said, absolutely not. And so Susie Lanier took this picture. So obviously a well-known figure in this institution. And Dr. Cooley was just as nice and a perfect gentleman, and honored this request, which was completely out of the blue. And my father-in-law has publicized this, obviously, throughout the world. It's like, I know Dr. Cooley. I know Dr. Cooley. And so just an awesome place at that time. And my very first circulation publication, Dr. Cooley was a co-author and Dr. Lushanowski was a co-author. And it was a special time. Dr. Willerson was the editor-in-chief of circulation, and this was just a thriving, powerful institution. And obviously it still is. And so you guys are very fortunate to be here, and I was very fortunate to have those opportunities. So with that, I usually like to start my lectures, especially Grand Rounds lectures, with a few questions, and hopefully I'll be able to answer them for you as we move through. So what is the reported prevalence of HCM in the general population? So 1 in 50, 1 in 500, 1 in 1500, or 1 in 10,000? What's the typical mode of inheritance from a Mendelian perspective? Is it autosomal dominant, recessive, X-linked, or it's not genetically transmitted? Maybe that's a possibility. Systemic anticoagulation should be strongly considered in patients with HCM and AFib. True or false? And then lastly, this will be interested, Dr. Angelini already knows the answer, but patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy should be restricted from all competitive sports. So keep those in mind. So we'll go through this. So as Dr. Willerson alluded to, this is where I spend my time, as genetically triggered cardiovascular disease, specifically myopathies and aortopathies. While I was here, we had the good fortune of working, obviously, with Dr. Caselli, Diana Milowitz. So Houston is obviously a mecca and a groundbreaking place for aortic disease. But of the five types, at least in the United States, that we identify as heritable forms of cardiomyopathy are hypertrophic, which we'll talk about today, dilated, LVNC, which is where most of my research and clinical interests lie, restrictives, and then arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathies, which was formerly ARVC, but now we're understanding there's an ALVC and a biventricular. So knowledge on that disease is evolving. And this is kind of a takeaway slide. If you can memorize this, you'll know most of what you need to know for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, at least currently. So the genetic triggers we'll talk a little bit more about, but typically they're sarcomeric based. So I know it's been a long time since physiology class. I'll show you a cartoon about what I'm talking about. RASopathy, so that may not be a term that's familiar to you, but that's such things such as Noonan syndrome, Costello syndrome. Metabolic disease, neurodegenerative like Friedreich's, and then mitochondrial disease, which we have world experts here in the medical center on mitochondrial myopathies. Symptoms are quite variable. We'll talk a little bit about that. And obviously they're very different in a child than they may be in a 22-year-old or even a 50-year-old. The current treatments, beta blockade, calcium channel blockers, myectomy, AICD, I think are going to be maybe fading a bit once I show you some of the data that we have at the end. And then, as I said, it is genetically triggered, and it is a dominant mutation typically in the sarcomeric world and in most of the other syndromic forms of inheritance, except for some isolated examples that we'll talk about. There's obvious cellular derangements, including calcium mishandling. And the survival, there's some nice data that the Marins have published, but in the contemporary world, if you are managed in an HCM center of excellence, quote unquote, your outcomes can be that of the general population. So it's very important that someone knows about HCM if they're going to manage your care. So it's very genetically heterogeneous. And as you'll learn, you know, we try and keep it simple for now when we talk about genetics and disease. And we always try and say, you know, this one gene is responsible for this phenotype, right? The more I do genetics, I recognize that that's absolutely incorrect most of the time. Remember, we're talking about one gene in the milieu of 25,000 genes, and that doesn't include intronic data. That's purely exons. So it's oftentimes that it may not just be one gene, but you may have multiple genes that are involved. So that complicates things a bit if you try and do genetic testing. But it's something that we still do, and it's still a strongly recommended guideline-based therapy or strategy is to do that. So we still pursue that. But sometimes people may be completely asymptomatic, and as you know, many adolescent and young adult athletes, the presenting symptom they have is sudden cardiac arrest. So it's an important disease, and I try and stress to my primary care docs, this is a disease you do not want to miss. If you have any concern, refer them, period, because this could result in a catastrophic outcome. And while here in Houston, you know, I would see people from all of the professional teams and the collegiate level teams, and it's a serious disease, and it's a hard thing if you have to tell someone you can't play football, basketball, whatever the case may be. But you really have to think about it in a very, you know, in a very thoughtful way. You have to respect this disease. It can be from infancy, which is usually mitochondrial mediated, up to middle age. And we used to think classically that if you made it up to the age of 30, you would never manifest the phenotype of HCM, which is actually not correct. So I've actually diagnosed people who have had normal echocardiograms who manifested the phenotype in their early 50s. So the idea of lifelong screening is something that I personally promote. Genetic causes are multiple, and the penetrance can be variable. So that's back to how do you present phenotypically. So could it be that you have very mild asymmetric septal hypertrophy, no obstruction, and otherwise do well? Or could it be that you have severe obstruction, you have concomitant atrial fibrillation, all those things, you can have very severe phenotypes. And at the worst end of that spectrum is sort of our burnt out hypertrophic phenotypes that ultimately may require a transplant. So it's quite a variable disease, which makes it interesting from my perspective. Obviously, Joe and Ray recognize there are different morphologies that you can see on imaging. And the prognosis is quite broad. And much of it, the underlying piece is that if you have isolated HCM and you're managed in a good center, as I said, you're going to do well. But if you have concomitant mitochondrial disease, or if you have concomitant Friedrich's ataxia or something like that, then that obviously changes the trajectory or changes your longitudinal possibilities for a long-term outcome. Clinical manifestations, I think everyone is aware. Obviously, diastology is an important consideration in HCM. And as I said, we do have maybe 10-15% of our HCMs go on to this burned out phenotype, quote unquote, where it's more of a dilated phenotype. And you can imagine the management for that obviously is very different than someone who has HCM, who's thick and has hypercontractile function. Sudden death is the thing we want to avoid. The systolic dysfunction we've talked about, and then obviously the inherent valvular abnormalities. Mayo has made a strong living off of this about myectomy and concomitant valve interventions and chordal reattachments and those sorts of things. So you have to be cognizant of that when you're looking on imaging. So I want to bring this up just so everyone kind of understands the literature. So I trained with Dr. Tobin, as Dr. Willerson mentioned, who doesn't agree with this slide, so I'll tell you that ahead of time, but there are some people that feel very strongly about this. So so when you think about LVH and you're thinking truly about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, are they all the same regardless of their etiology? So someone who you just put up the echo and Dr. Steinbach says, well, that's obviously hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but then I say, well, the patient has Friedrich's ataxia. Is that really hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? So if you talk to other leaders in the field, like Dr. Seidman in Boston or others, they'll tell you that that patient has an HCM phenocopy. So they're not classically hypertrophic because they don't have sarcomerically mediated disease. We think, on the other hand, it's sort of a final common pathway, and the phenotype is the phenotype, and we manage them the same way. So it's just something to keep in mind. And I'll talk a little bit more about this with a specific disease in a few minutes, but just be cognizant that when people talk about HCM, they are typically talking about sarcomerically mediated disease. And I'll show you more about that in a few minutes. So one of your other questions was about prevalence. So the reported prevalence is 1 in 500. I can tell you as a practitioner, that's an underestimate because we don't screen everyone, right? And many people are completely asymptomatic. So they go through life and they may harbor that mutation, have a very mild phenotype and never know about it. So, you know, they're not going to get triggered for an echo unless someone's concerned about a pathologic murmur or unless there's a family history or an EKG abnormality. So we are underestimating the disease as we are for all genetically triggered cardiomyopathies. There is a slight male preponderance. It can present at any time as we've talked about, but those critical times are adolescence and early adulthood. It currently accounts for almost half of our pediatric cardiomyopathies. The inheritance or incidence, I mean, is about 0.47 per 100,000, but it is a frequent cause of sudden cardiac death, so you can't miss it. If you see a newspaper headline about someone dying on a football field, a soccer pitch, this is the disease that's primarily responsible for that. And then you get into other things like coronary anomalies, myocarditis, channelopathies, but HCM is still the driver for most of that disease. And it's really the classic Braunwald definition and Willerson definition. If you look at the textbooks, unexplained LVH, so no systemic hypertension, no end-stage renal, any of that sort of business. And if you look under a microscope, the disease is very distinctive. So it's myocyte disarray. So if you think about your myocytes, they're organized in a very structured parallel fashion. I consider HCM as if you had a bunch of pixie sticks, if you remember what those are, and you throw them on the ground, they all kind of go like this, right? Well, that's kind of what these muscles look like under a microscope. So you can imagine the ability to have adequate relaxation is inherently compromised. So that's just something to think about from a basic science perspective. Phenotypically, as you all know, they're hypercontractile typically. And when you see that contractility going down, you need to pay attention to that patient. They have reduced compliance. And as I said, they can present essentially at any age. And the key word of all of this is that it can be progressive, okay? And hopefully one of the things that you'll take away, and we'll talk a little bit about the genetics, is that this is a lifelong concern if you harbor the genetic trigger, okay? So that's why we do genetic testing, because you never know when things are going to crop up. And unfortunately, many people will have a family history of HCM. And, you know, the appropriate way to look at that is what's called cascade screening. So that means we screen all first degree relatives, so parents, siblings, and children. And unfortunately, many of the children will, they may see a cardiologist, they may get an echo, and it'll be normal, not surprisingly. And the cardiologist will say, you're completely fine, you never need to see a cardiologist again. That is unequivocally the wrong answer. So the main thing that you should take away is if they are at risk, they do benefit from lifelong screening. So remember that in your clinics. They may have a normal phenotype now, but in 2 to 3 years, it may be completely different. And we're talking about a disease that you could, if you're monitoring correctly, you can prevent a sudden cardiac death. So keep that in mind. Echo, I won't bother too much with all this. I'm sure most of the audience is very familiar. Obviously, we're paying attention to atrial size, which factors in sometimes into risk factor calculations. Extreme phenotypes, you know, obviously you can see from across the room, but there are more subtle phenotypes that you have to pay attention to. And this is a classic example. This is, you know, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And I'll tell you, you know, and if I were to show this image to anyone, they would say that's HCM. And I would, you know, but the important thing is this is actually a patient with Noonan syndrome. So they had extreme septal hypertrophy. So that's the other part of this. If you have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, consider a broader differential. So if they have a sarcomeric mutation, that's fine. You worry about the cardiovascular system. But let's say they have Noonan syndrome, or they have, you know, if they are a Friedreich's, what else needs to be done? Well, there's a lot that needs to be done because their other organ systems can be involved and they need appropriate screening and surveillance. So keep that in your mind when you're looking at these patients for surveillance, because it's not just about the heart necessarily. It can involve other organs and systems as well. And obviously this is just images depicting obstruction, which is something that we obviously try and mitigate. So most centers that I think are high-level hypertroph centers leverage two types of imaging. So they're going to do echo and stress echo. So they're looking for gradients that may not exist at rest but can be provoked with stress, which is important because that leads you down some treatment pathways, but also using CMR. Well, in my time at Texas Heart, Scott Flam was here, and he's a world leader in cardiac MRI, and we spent a lot of time talking about this disease with him. But there are a lot of obvious reasons to do it that I probably don't need to tell everyone in the audience about. Our main thing is we want to characterize the myocardium, and I'll explain more about that in a few minutes. And there's no radiation, so, you know, longitudinally, you can continue to do this, and it gives you a lot of data. So this is the classic thing that's becoming a little more antiquated, surprisingly enough, but the idea of, can we identify a surrogate of scar? And we can, using gadolinium, and everyone in the audience is familiar with that. So you look for late gadolinium enhancement. The problem is gadolinium is increasingly found to have some potentially toxic effects. So the exposure to gadolinium will probably continue to decline and potentially be taken away in the future by the FDA, because it does lead to some residual staining in the brain and other areas, and no one knows what clinically what that means. So let's say I'm doing cardiac MRIs on a 20-year-old, that's a lot of gadolinium exposure over time. People are gonna say, is that really safe or not? And I don't think anyone knows the answer, but there are data that are increasingly being reported. So the question is, well, what can we do to get around that, right? What if I don't have to put an IV in, and what if I could do it without any kind of contrast agent? And it turns out you can. So this is something that Scott was working on a little bit while I was here, but it's the idea of T1 mapping. So you can easily, you know, upgrade your software system in your MRI suites to be able to do this. And it really is very nice because you can do what's called pre-contrast T1 mapping, and I'll show you some images in a few minutes. But they actually are quite comparable to gadolinium administration. And as I said, it can be performed without contrast. And this is interesting because it not only gives you information about intracellular space, but it also gives you information about the extracellular space, such as edema or deposition. So remember, some diseases are not just about sarcomere. Some are deposition-based disease, such as Pompe, for example, is a classic example. And I'll show you one more in a few minutes. So these are some MRI images on patients with a variety of conditions. So you can look at the top, and you see normal post-MI, diffuse fibrosis, so someone had significant AS, replacement fibrosis also from AS, and then on the far right is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And you can see that native T1, which is in the middle, those numbers go up. So you start at about 1,100, which would be normal, but as those numbers start to go up, it's very consistent with myocardial pathology. And you can see at the bottom, the post-contrast T1s very much match up to the native T1 imaging. So the idea, do you have to give contrast, is really in question. You probably don't if you have the ability to interpret this well. And these are some of the data we're starting to acquire on all of our cardiomyopathies, but I think it has very special interest possibilities in the area of HCM. And the one I want to draw your attention to is ECV. So that's extracellular volume. How can we calculate that? And interestingly enough, you actually can. So you can do this on an MRI. All you need is a concomitant hematocrit. And that's pretty interesting, and I'll show you why in a few minutes, but up till now, we really haven't been able to distinguish that sort of a characteristic when it comes to characterization. So as in many of the diseases we deal with, you get expansion of this extracellular volume, and you can see this both in isolated systolic failure, isolated diastolic, or in a combination, which is, you know, quite common, as you know. And it's really regardless of the etiology. And this process actually offers prognostic information. So we'll talk a little bit about risk factors for sudden cardiac death, and it's typically based on LGE data. Now I'm talking about a completely different technology that we could leverage to risk stratify people with HCM. And recently, MR techniques have been developed to do this. So this is an MR map of ECV, and you can see the postmortems on the right and B and C. And it's very well characterizing the extracellular space non-invasively. And as I said, all you need is a hematocrit and a calculator to be able to do this. So this is kind of the next area of where we're going in cardiomyopathies in general. And the data are there. You just need a little bit of software to generate them. But once again, it's further characterizing what we would call the phenotype of HCM. And these are some data that came out. Now, these are on ischemic myopathy patients. You can appreciate as your ECV changes, as it goes up, your mortality is strongly affected. So if we could collect data and help leverage these data in the management of HCM, I find that to be an exciting opportunity. And we're doing it in a specific disease that I'll talk about in just a few minutes. So genetics behind this disease evolve every day. Essentially, new mutations are identified. So we have a set number of genes, but remember, mutations can occur anywhere within those genes. So you come up with new mutations being reported, or at least potentially causative alleles that need to be verified as pathogenic mutations. But it's an important thing because it gives us an understanding of mechanism and potential targets for therapy. And it is, Dr. Willison said, this is something that we spend a lot of time on. So just to come back, you know, to general science, back when you're in grade school, you know, the P's and how are they inherited and traits that are passed down. Well, HCM classically, unless you have a mitochondrial disease or something else, is typically autosomal dominant. So what does that mean? Well, as you remember, it means if you harbor that mutation, it's a 50-50 that you pass it on to your child. And that 50-50 recurs with each child, right? So it's a coin flip every time, every time, every time. So that's an answer to another question, is that's the typical mode of inheritance. For the fellows, this is the thing you need to know for the boards, is what are the typical mutations associated with HCM? The most common is MYBPC3. Next most common is MYH7 or beta-myosin heavy chain. These comprise the majority of the cases that have HCM with a genetically identified trigger. So remember that. As we said, non-sarcomeric genes are reported. And then some of these genes are responsible for things like Pompe, we mentioned, Noonan, we mentioned, and Fabry. And this is a more detailed list of some of those genes. And some of these proteins you're familiar with, right? Troponin, tropomyosin. So you've heard these. They're actually implicated in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So obviously you use them as diagnostic tests and your STEMI evaluations and those sorts of things. But they are very helpful when it comes to HCM understanding. And then there are some ZDIS genes, which I won't spend too much time on. But I want to come back to the non-sarcomeric piece. These are the ones that are evolving. So if you read, you know, CIRC, JACC, New England Journal, there's a lot of focus on hereditary amyloidosis, so specifically a thing called HATTR. And that's mediated by transthyretin. And actually, the reason it's important, because there are evolving therapies that can actually make a difference in that disease, which, you know, can be a very difficult disease to manage. So remember that. So amyloid, there's a potential possibility. But the other one I want you to take a look at is a disease called Fabry, and that's by galactosidase alpha. And so that is also someone who can manifest with a hypertrophic phenotype. So I want to spend a few minutes on that, because that's another board question that you're going to see. So keep this one in mind. So this is a progressive disease. It actually starts in utero, and it's a deposition-based disease. So it's basically the lysosomes, if you remember back, you know, sort of the garbage cans of the cells, if you will, where you're depositing stuff, digesting, removing. When those are dysfunctional, bad stuff accrues, essentially, and that leads to cell lysis, fibrosis, different sorts of things. And it's all driven by problems with alpha-gal. So it's a very debilitating disease. And you can imagine over time, deposition is going to continue to accrue. So you're going to manifest pathology. And typically that's in the brain, the heart, and the kidneys. So keep that in mind. And they can be life-threatening complications. And we manage a lot of the Fabry patients in the country because there's just not a lot of knowledge about this in most cardiology practices. And this is kind of the graph that shows you the progression of the disease. And as I said, prenatally, it's already, the deposition is already occurring. But during childhood, you'll start seeing some manifestations that are very nondescript. So abdominal pain, they suffer from anhidrosis. So in Houston, they would do horribly in the summertime, go outside, they can't sweat. So they can only play for a minute or two and they're back inside. So those are classic childhood presentations. And then you start getting tissue involvement, specifically kidney. So you start seeing proteinuria. And then you start seeing cardiac involvement. And I'll give you a slide in just a minute to talk about that, which leads to premature death. And most people, if they did an echo and saw HCM, really wouldn't think about Fabry. So they wouldn't say, you have problems with anhidrosis. They may not check a urinalysis, those sorts of things. But this disease matters, and this gives you sort of a timeline of the disease that develops, and cardiac dysfunction is the main one. That's the leading killer in this particular disease. We are wondering, like, well, why am I talking about Fabry? Well, this is the only disease, when we talk about HCM, that actually offers a potential therapeutic strategy that could in some ways at least reverse part of the disease. It's not curative, it's not gene therapy, but it can actually reverse some of the pathology that we see, and that's in the form of enzyme replacement therapy. So they're missing an enzyme, we give it, and then hopefully gets intracellular and actually functions the way that we want it to. And so these are the things that you can see in Fabry. They can be cardiac, they can be vascular. So your board question is probably going to be, you know, a 35-year-old comes in with recurrent strokes, and you notice hypertrophy on the EKG and the echocardiogram, and there's a strong family history of similar, so early strokes, and they're also noted to be suffering from stage 4 CKD, something like that. Think about Fabry. That's the answer, okay? If you see early stroke, early hypertrophic disease, and concomitant renal disease, the answer is Fabry. So keep that in mind. And the other part, so this was back to what we do from a research perspective, is that this, we were talking about those T1 scores and where normal is, quote unquote, this is the only disease that we know of where the T1s go down. So you don't have to be a rocket scientist to look at the MR data and say, I think that's probably Fabry disease. So that also makes it a little bit easier if you leverage that technology. And this is that T1 mapping, which you can read on the left as normal. And in the middle, you can obviously see lighter colors, some blues and yellows, very different than that circular green. You can appreciate how that matches up with the late gadolinium enhancement by classic MRI imaging. So just something for you to take away. So when I see someone with HCM, I'm typically concerned about two or three things. So first is, are they symptomatic? Okay, so that's typically where management is geared, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Second is, I need to stratify them for sudden cardiac death risk, because that's going to be that's the main theme, and that's what we really need to take care of. And then other things that we need to be concomitantly, or they're potentially associated, about 20-25% will develop atrial fibrillation, about 25-30% have obstructive sleep apnea. So there are other things that you have to think about to watch for down the road as you manage these patients. And this is from Bernie Gersh. This is a guideline statement that's a little bit antiquated, hasn't been updated in obviously in a few years. But this is kind of the pathway of how we deal with patients. And it really, that first line is triggered by whether you have obstruction or not. And it actually isn't just obstruction, but it's typically obstruction associated with symptoms. And that's when we talk about using medical therapies such as beta blockers or calcium channel blockers or disopyramide. So that kind of gives you an idea about the flow, and the continuation of that diagram is here. If they continue to have symptoms and you've done all you can medically, at least in the current era, then you would consider other therapies such as myectomy or consider alcohol septal ablation. So Houston was a big driver of alcohol septal ablation. Over 1,000 cases were done at Methodist. So this was a large area for that. And my argument's always been, I don't really think we need it. I think we can manage these patients medically. So I've probably seen, 3,000, 4,000 hypertrophs in my career at this point, and I've sent less than 20 for myectomy. Whereas if I were at the Mayo Clinic, everybody gets a myectomy. So it's just the difference in philosophy. We feel strongly, and my mentor in this, Dr. Tobin, felt strongly as well, and Frank Smart, who was here as well. So that you can actually manage these patients medically, and you can. That's been our clinical experience. And I'm going to show you some data that we can actually do a better job of managing them from a non-invasive management strategy. So this is back to our other question. Participation, competitive, or recreational sports? The answer is no. You can look on the right for things that are low risk, quote unquote, that you can do. But football, basketball, baseball, all those things are out. So typically we tell our patients avoid burst activity and avoid isometric exercises. So anybody that's in a sport like football is going to be lifting weights. Not a good thing. You already have a hypertrophied heart, and let's put some increased afterload on that. That is not a good thing long term. So that's the answer to one of our other questions. So we stratify in the US, and I'll tell you about the European system in just a minute, but these are the classically accepted ways to risk stratify someone for potential need of ICD. Okay. So non-sustained VT, which, as you know, sometimes is hard to document, but in the current era with loop recorders is becoming easier and easier. Extreme LVH, so typically greater than 3 centimeters. A family history of sudden cardiac death, typically a first degree relative that is thought to be from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Unexplained syncope, which is the one I get to deal with most of the time, which is a difficult thing to adjudicate. A hypotensive blood pressure response on exercise. So typically, obviously, your blood pressure should go up. But if you're manifesting obstruction, your blood pressure is going to go down. And then last one is the newest criteria, where we leverage late gadolinium enhancement. It's really about the volume of the LV that's occupied. And I think most people would agree that anything above 20% or so, if the LV is occupied by fibrosis, that is an independent risk factor for sudden cardiac death. So this is once again from Dr. Gersh. This is the sort of pathway that is recommended. I can't say that I don't deviate from this occasionally, because I do. But this would be the classic approach. And you can see the level of recommendation based on color coding that's associated with the findings. So And there are patients that don't get an ICD. And honestly, the overwhelming majority of our patients never get an ICD, but you still have to reevaluate this every time. Every time they come to clinic, you need to be redoing these tests and seeing, have the risk factors changed? Well, as typical, European recommendations aren't always consistent with US. So Perry Elliott is a good friend. And so he headed up the European sort of undertaking of risk stratifying hypertrophic patients. And you'll see that many of these are similar. One thing that's different, though, is the left atrial diameter. So that's something that's a little bit different, and age. And so why do we care about age? Well, interestingly, if you have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and you live, so I saw a patient this week who was 75 and he was like, should I get an ICD? And I was like, well, in actuality, your risks are going down as you get older. So it sort of makes sense that you've lived with this disease. Your active, quote unquote, days are mostly behind you. So is your risk really enough to warrant consideration of an ICD? So that's a thoughtful discussion that you have to have. But nicely enough, Perry and his co-investigators provided us with a, you know, a very simple formula, as you can appreciate. But there actually is a website that will do this for you, and you can plug in the data, and it will shoot out for you what they think the probability at 5 years will be for this particular patient from a sudden death perspective. And this is their diagram regarding both primary prevention and secondary prevention. Secondary prevention is pretty easy. You know, someone arrests from HCM and they have a 1 year or greater expected survival, then they get an ICD. The others are where you become a little more complicated. And this idea of low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk, I would say that those lines are blurry if you do this long enough. So these really well-characterized little silos often don't exist in clinical practice. So I personally take this with a grain of salt. And so back to that, you know, we come back to the idea that really the population we're worried about are the kids and the young adults, right? Those are the people that are dying of sudden cardiac death. So I'm a part of an investigation called the Primacy Study. So we had a question was, could we apply these ESC guidelines that Perry had outlined and develop a calculator for kids? So something similar, but for a completely different population. So we're doing all this right now, and the data are actually quite compelling that we can. So in children, we try and observe the same sort of risk factors, but a four-year-old wouldn't be expected to manifest a 3-centimeter septum, right? That doesn't, you know, from we use Z-scores in pediatrics. And so it's a very different thing when we're talking about how thick is too thick or what is extreme thickness in a young child. It's a different cutoff. So we have to think about that differently. So we can't apply many of the standard criteria that we would use when we manage pediatric HCM. So these are just some of the inclusion criteria, and they're pretty straightforward. But interesting, as I say, the data are interesting that it may work out. The other thing is that there's been some repurposing of existing drugs in this disease, so specifically ARBs. And so we're a part of a trial that I'll talk about in just a few minutes, but much of the pathology is related to TGF-beta in this disease. And so if we could interfere with that pathway, is there some way that we might disrupt some of the end organ problems that we see, such as fibrosis? And interestingly, you can. So most of the time, if you think about HCM classically, especially with someone that's obstructive, it is counterintuitive to use an ARB or an ACE, right? Because you're reducing afterload, potentially changing the gradient. But in these patients, we've actually seen some compelling data. So this is a study called VANISH, and it's being run by Carolyn Hole out of the Brigham, and we're a part of this study. But we're doing exactly that, is giving people with early evidence and relatively asymptomatic ARB and seeing what makes it, seeing if we see a difference or not. And we actually are. And this just depicts where we're impacting TGF-beta. And up there on the top left, you can see that sarcomere that we were talking about a little bit. But at a cellular level, what are we really doing? Ultimately, much of the disease is because of force. And so if we can mitigate that in some way via an ARB, we can disrupt the TGF triggering and ultimately, hopefully, impact the amount of fibrosis burden. And then back to symptoms. So I said, that's the second thing that we worry about. So this is the cool part. So this is cutting edge science that we're very interested in. So if you think about the mechanics from contractility, you know, you remember back to binding and, you know, grab and pull sort of a thing. What if we could interfere with that mechanism at the myocyte level? And it turns out that we can. So there's a drug called mavacamten, which is a small molecule that modulates striated muscles, specifically myosin. So it selectively targets myosin, and it reversibly, critical, reversibly inhibits its binding to actin. So by definition, that would reduce force. So the mechanism, based on that, we predicted, well, it could mitigate LV outflow tract obstruction and potentially could reduce hypertrophy if given long enough. And this is back to the cartoon we were talking about, and you can see representations of actin and myosin there. And as I said, all of these proteins are implicated in cardiomyopathies, whether it's a dilated phenotype, a hypertrophic phenotype, whatever the case may be. And those junctions, you see the desmosomal proteins are responsible for the arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathies, just as an aside. So these are the data on mavacamten. And interestingly enough, they're quite compelling, and I don't want to spend too much time on this, but this was a study in symptomatic patients with obstruction. They were all greater than class two. They had preserved ejection fraction. And then there were some key exclusion criteria. So we gave the drug for a period of time, and then we stopped it during a washout period. We had some very delineated endpoints. Mostly for this one, it was a change in peak LVOT gradient at week 12. So they had been on therapy for that long. But there are a lot of other endpoints that you can appreciate here. And so it was a very small trial. So you can imagine that's any statistician would tell you, you're probably underpowered to accomplish anything, which why I think the data are even more compelling. So this is what happened with LVO outflow tract obstruction, is that you can see it either stayed the same or in many patients declined. And when you drop the drug off, it actually increased again. So that's back to that reversibility endpoint. This is also just a cumulative slide that once again, you can see a nice decline with therapy and then a bounce back after you stop. These are changes ejection fraction wise. So you can appreciate there are some modulations of contractility. And importantly, we improve peak VO2. So that I think is a very important finding when we talk about symptoms, quote unquote, with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. We improve dyspnea scores. And for many patients, the majority of patients, their functional class was improved. And all of those you can see went back down after they stopped the drug. So pretty strong argument that it was based on the drug, looking at Koch's postulates or whatever you want to. And then the NT-proBNPs you see also declined and then went back up after stopping therapy. And there were really no major safety events. So that triggered the idea of, well, we need to do a larger study. Maybe we actually need to do two studies. So that's what we're doing now, is we're looking in patients both that have HCM with obstruction and HCM without obstruction. So those two studies I'm going to talk about in just a few minutes, but this is just sort of a summary that we really had good results that were statistically significant in a very small patient cohort, which is very encouraging. So that's what triggered these two trials that are currently ongoing, which are called Explore-HCM and Maverick-HCM. So Explore is looking for 220 patients, and we're still enrolling actively for this. But we're looking for patients with obstruction, and we're doing other things like rhythm monitoring and accelerometers. And these are the inclusion criteria. Basically, the main thing is that you need a significant gradient, meaning 50 or more. That's kind of the cutoff. And the timeline, as you can appreciate, is not hugely dissimilar to what we did in Pioneer. And the primary endpoint is an improvement in their peak VO2s, as well as a change in their New York Heart class based on those data that I was showing you. And we also have nested a cohort that we're participating in where we do MR for many of the reasons that I explained to you earlier. The other study is Maverick, which was in the patients without obstruction, which is actually completed enrollment, and very similar outcomes. They wanted to assess for safety because we hadn't looked at it in a patient with non-obstructive disease, but many of the other objectives are very similar to explore. So, and once again, this is the timeline. So I don't want to bore you with the particulars of the study, but what I want you to take away is this is a completely, this is a paradigm shift in the management of HCM. So that means we could take away beta blockers, verapamil, disopyramide potentially, and potentially take away the need for myectomy and or septal alcohol ablation with an oral therapy. So that's pretty revolutionary. And so we're very excited about this, and we think that this holds great promise for HCM. So this is just that summary slide, once again, just to ingrain it into your mind. So let's go back to our questions. So what's the reported prevalence? We talked about it's 1 in 500, but I would argue with anyone that it's probably 1 in 300, 1 in 350. But that, those are the quoted data, quote unquote. What's the typical mode of inheritance? It's typically autosomal dominant, so that could also be a board question. Should you anticoagulate patients? We didn't get a chance to talk about this, but this is actually in the guidelines. Anyone with HCM and AFib, regardless of any kind of CHADS2 VASC or any other kind of scoring, they all should be placed on systemic anticoagulation. So keep that in mind when you see hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with AFib. And then should they play competitive sports? Unfortunately, no. And that's how I spend most of my time, is telling people that they can't. So in conclusion, this is a clinically and genetically heterogeneous disease. Keep that in mind. It could be very subtle, or it could slap you in the face. As I say, you could see it from the parking lot. It's a broad range of presenting symptoms, but the majority of patients are asymptomatic. So most of the patients that I follow are captured because of that cascade screening, because a father died suddenly while exercising. So I screen his siblings, his parents, and his children, and we'll wind up finding other cases. In many cases, they have true pathology. And I've had cases where they've passed out four or five times and their ER primary doctor said, it's all vasovagal, don't worry about it. When in actuality, they were probably having aborted sudden death events. So that's how we acquire most of our patients with this disease. Targets for management, obviously, are risk stratification. I would say that's always at the top of the list. Symptom mitigation, management of arrhythmias, and then treatment of resultant heart failure. Our risk continues to, our understanding gets a little bit better, and how are we going to sort of incorporate genetic data into that scoring system is an important question. And as I said, we can typically mitigate obstructive symptoms with medical therapy, and with mavacamten, I think we'll be able to mitigate pretty much all of them. A lot of focus in peds on HCM. We need more tools. We've talked about valsartan does have some promise, but these myosin modulators are really probably the next frontier when it comes to HCM management. And as I said, the overwhelming, like 99% of the patients are going to do exceptionally well if they are managed appropriately. Very, very few patients die of sudden death with HCM, but it's always in a young person. So it's a very impactful event. So it's not like you're going to see lots of people in Houston dying from HCM, but you will see a few, and they're going to be publicized everywhere. And it's important that you make sure you identify and manage those patients appropriately. And we have numerous professional sports reports of this where they were being managed and told it was okay to play, and then they die on the court. And there's a very famous one from Boston. So you have to remember that and treat this disease with respect. And if you have any questions, send the patient to someone that you can actually has a familiarity with HCM. And then lastly, I would tell you that these are very good resources. If you have a question about HCM, they're a great way for your patients. You know, the first thing I tell any cardiomyopathy patient when they come to me is don't believe everything on the internet. That's my first statement to them. And it's absolutely true. Go to a reliable source. And these sources are quite reliable. So with that, I want to thank you for your time. It's been an absolute pleasure to be back at Texas Heart, and I'd be glad to entertain any questions.